महाहरि ओम गणानांत्वा गणपति गुम्हवामहे कविं कवीनामुपमश्रवस्तमं ज्येष्ठराजं ब्रह्मणां ब्रह्मणस्पत आनश्रुण्वन्नोतिभिः सीद सादनम् श्री महागणाधिपतये नमः सदाशिवसमारंभां शंकराचार्यमध्यमां अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वंदे गुरुपरंपराम् नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरयेत्। आत्मस्वरूप बंधुगण, वी वर लुकिंग एट द सेवेंथ वर्स फर्स्ट हाफ एंड द सेकंड हाफ हैज टू बी कंबाइंड विथ द फर्स्ट हाफ ऑफ द एइथ वर्स। दैट इज हाउ द अन्वया इज सिंटैक्स, सो दैट इज हाउ इट वर्क्स देयर। We will say the eighth verse once. Shariram yadavapnoti yachapyutkramatishvarah grihitvaitani sanyati vayurgandhani vashayat। You see, this non-dual Brahman and the world of plurality, these two levels have to be carefully understood. On one side we say everything else is mithya, only Brahman is the satyam, and that Brahman is non-dual. There is nothing like a jiva, there is nothing like a universe, there is only Brahman. Sadekameva somyedamagra asi. Even now, Sat is the only reality. Sadayatanaha, Satpratishthaha, Sanmulaha. Everything is Sat only. All is an appearance. So, but still, the human being, the seeker, you see, Shastram is meant for the seeker. And Shastram has to come to the level of the seeker and teach him. We have a statement. You have to start the journey from where you are. That is how it has to go. So, how the Shastram finds the seeker? What is his situation? He is a limited being. And he is so sure that he is a limited being. He finds himself as a becoming person. So, he understands that he has taken birth. And he is sure that he is going to die, and sometimes he is afraid of that death also. And he somehow gets some information about the paraloka, the other world. Shastram tells him. So, there is a paraloka, the journey doesn't come to an end with the fall of this body. The journey continues. The body dies, but the Atman or the Jiva survives the death of the body. So, I tell you, in this universe, in this world, except Charvakas, a group of people who were inspired by a sage called Charvaka Maharshi, except these Charvakas and the counterparts in other parts of the world, who are the agnostics and who are the nastikas, who are the non-believers. So, except these people, their number is always small, except a few of them, the entire humanity understands that the individual or the jiva, the so-called jiva, survives the death of the body. All faiths, they are based on this presumption. That is the premise on which a faith proceeds. So, suppose everything comes to an end with death, then there is nothing like pursuing a virtue or planning for the life after death. All these ideas will not be there. But we understand, based on our teaching of Shastra, that, and also a little rationale is also there. So based on that, we understand that the jiva is distinct from the body. He abides in this body, all right, but he continues to survive even after the death of this body, and he will assume another body. This is understood. On this basis, this is at the level of the empirical reality, taking that the universe is there, and the plurality of the universe is also taken into account. All this is taken for granted for the present. And in that level, we have this discussion. And from that level only, all this discussion is being presented here. If you rise from this level to the absolute reality level, then there is only Sat, everything else is Mithya, and therefore any discussion about the Mithya is irrelevant, and so you can stop all this discussion. Both viewpoints are there. For example, there are any number of occasions when a seeker approaches a Mahatma and asks, "Sir, what was I in my earlier birth? What will happen to me after this birth?" Then the Mahatma says, "Why you worry about earlier birth and the next birth? Why not try to understand yourself now and here? By the time you understand what you are now, then all your doubts and anxieties about the next birth, etc., will vanish. Because there is nothing like a next birth for you." This is how a Mahatma like Ramana Bhagavan, he will say like this. If you ask this question, he says like that. Like that, any number of Mahatmas are there who will directly answer the question like that. But you know, the other person should be ready to take it. If he is ready to take it, then there is no further discussion. There is no rebirth and all that. Rebirth for what? So, there is no rebirth. Suppose you take a necklace, melt it down, and then make a bracelet. Now it is a rebirth. For what? From the point of view of gold, there is no rebirth. It continues to be gold. When it was necklace, it is gold. When it was melted down, it is gold. And in the new incarnation of a bracelet also, it is gold. From the gold point of view, there is no change whatsoever. So, only from the empirical reality point of view, a discussion is possible. Even when we talk of an amsha, this amshatvam should not give any idea that the duality is somehow there. That is not the idea of this amshatvam. We always mention an amsha only from the empirical reality point of view. It is like the part space is an amsha, is a part of the Mahakasha, the total space. Only from the upadhi, from the point of view of upadhi, the adjunct that is part, from that point of view alone, we talk of a part space. Otherwise, there is nothing like a part space. In fact, we were compelled to talk of a part space because it somehow happens to serve a purpose for us. It helps us to keep a few things in it. And thereby, in an empirical life, it is used by us. It has a utilitarian value. And based on that, we impart a reality to that, some reality. We are not at ready to totally disregard its existence. So that's why we divide these realities. So two levels of reality we take into account. And from the point of view of empirical reality alone, assuming that I as a limited being exist, as of now as a limited being I exist, and I am trying to find out my non-difference with Ishvara or with Brahman. From that standpoint alone, we talk of an amsha. So, one has to look at it like that. And so, mamaivamsho jiva bhutah, mamaivamsho jiva loke jiva bhutas sanatanaha. So, we now assume that the jiva, though in reality he is not at all different from Ishvara or Brahman, he somehow has taken himself to be a limited being. So, in fact, I tell you, we always talk of jiva and Ishvara. If you take this jiva and dip him in the nectar of knowledge and take him out, then what comes out is Brahman. And this is called shodhana, jiva shodhana. Shodhana means purification. So take Ishvara and again, once again, put through this knowledge and take out, what you get is Brahman. So, we not only talk of the non-difference between Jiva and Brahman, we also try to establish the non-difference between Jiva and Ishvara by disregarding the respective upadhis. So, Jiva is Brahman with a particular upadhi called Jivatvam, and Ishvara is also Brahman with another upadhi, upadhi of the Maya Shakti. So, that is Ishvara. And these upadhis need not be taken seriously because they do not happen to be real. They are unreal, they are mithya upadhis. Therefore, jivo brahmaiva naparaha. Jiva and that is already there. Not only jivo brahmaiva naparaha, we also say jiva and Ishvara are not different. There can be distinction but not difference. Distinction in the sense the upadhi is different, that way the upadhis happen to be not same, but vastu is same. But when the person is not ready to take this reality into account, what we call abhyupagamya vada, as such the person takes himself to be a limited being. And now you can say you are ignorant and get out, and so leave him alone. That is one way of looking at it. Another way could be, okay, you are a limited being, but then you happen to be on the side of Ishvara, not on the side of Jagat. This is the idea of Mamaivamsho Jivaloke Jivabhuta Sanatanaha. I tell you, big, big scholars, people given to study of Shastras, etc., they take themselves to be limited beings. And they do not accept anything other than that. They are sure that they are limited beings, they are jivas. We have astrology, we have numerology, so many shastras which are based on the individual being a limited entity. That understanding, they are based on that understanding. And the entire karma kanda, so the body of knowledge which teaches number of rituals, the entire karmakanda is based on the understanding that the jiva is a limited entity, is a transmigratory soul. On that basis only, the entire karmakanda of the Veda is taught. All upasanas, without exception, every one of the upasanas, they take the jiva to be a limited entity who has to gain higher goals by virtue of this upasana. So, the entire upasana kanda also takes the jiva to be a limited entity. And all this discussion which we are having now is also based on that. Now you see, shariram yat avapnoti yachapi utkramat ishvaraha. These verses you recite all the time. Therefore, you may know the word-to-word meaning. That is the way I am analyzing all these days. So, yat cha api utkramati ishvaraha. You see, this word ishvaraha is a very interesting word. It means jiva. We are talking about jiva. Ishvaraha. Because the word ishvara means one who is in control of. That is the meaning of ishvara. Isha is the dhatu. Therefore, one who is in control of. Suppose a factory is there. The general manager is Ishvara for the factory. He is the Ishvara. We look at it like that. And for a country, the head of the nation, the head of the government, like a president, etc., he is Ishvara. And in a level of existence like Swarga, it is a level of existence. Shastram talks about it. And so, that is ruled by a lokapalaka called Indra, a devata called Indra. And so, he is Ishvara for Swargam. And for the entire universe, there is Ishvara again. And that Ishvara is called Hiranyagarbha, or some people call him Vishnu, some other people call him Shiva, some other people call him Father. So with different names they refer to that Ishvara, who is the overall controller of the entire universe. That is Ishvara. But at the same time, at the level of a physical body, sense organs and mind, you have an Ishvara. The Ishvara in this context is Jivaha. Therefore, Shankara says Ishvara. That is the way in which the word is used. It is not very special in this verse only. That is how it is used. So, Dehadi Sanghata Swami Jivaha. Swami. Swami means one who owns, one who controls. So, one who governs, that is the Swami. So, governor, that is the Swami. Therefore, this Dehadi Sanghata is there. It is centered around that aham, I, the limited being. I am a limited being, that person, that individual. So the body is around that person, the body is supposed to belong to him, senses, and also the mind, they are all centered around that aham. And he is the Swami. In fact, I tell you, they function like that only. It's not that we give a name to him as a Swami or Ishvara. It's not that way. They function like that. In fact, you see, you get up from sleep and the first stirring in the consciousness is I am. And with that I am comes here and now, the time and space. And then comes the body. All this you have to notice. You are in so hurry to go for a cup of coffee, then we miss all these things. But these are all there. When a person comes out of sleep, the entire sequence is there. First, the immediate stirring of consciousness is I am, followed by I am here and now. Time and space will come. Then the body will come. Along with the body, the entire universe comes. The entire world in which he lives, his world comes. Every person's world varies. So the world varies from person to person. So his world is in place. So, and his world consists of the mind and senses and body. And the physical level in which this body is living. So all this comes, and all these come after the I is in place. Therefore, everything is centered around I. If I is not there, there is no mind, there are no senses, there is no body, there is no world. If I is there, all these things come into place. That aham, you see, consciousness is very powerful. You should know that. We all the time talk of consciousness and awareness and like that. We use the words. It seems to be some dumb thing. It is not so. Because the entire power of prana, the metabolism, the heart pumping, blood flowing, inhalation, exhalation, digestion, all this power and the power of knowledge, thinking, emotions, the intellectual knowledge, all this power. And of course, the physical power I have already covered. All this power arises from that consciousness. All this comes from there. That is the source of the entire universe. And the power of the universe is called Maya Shakti. It abides in that consciousness, in that awareness, that Chaitanyam, that is Brahma it is. Therefore, one should not underestimate the power of consciousness. For example, in dream, a small speck of consciousness starts moving and you have a huge world. In dream, the entire dream world is created by a speck of consciousness in motion. So, the power of it one has to understand. So, that consciousness, its very fundamental manifestation is I, aham. And that aham is the most powerful. It is the source of all power. And if only you can know what it is, that aham, that is Atma, and that is Brahman. Aham Atma, Gudakesha, Sarva Bhutashaya Sthitaha. Anyway, so that aham taken as a limited being is called Jiva. And that Jiva is obviously the governor of this entire psychosomatic apparatus. So, Dehadi Sanghata Swami Jivaha, that is the meaning of Ishvaraha. This Ishvara, Yat Utkramati, Yat means Yada, Yasmin Kale, in which time, so in which time, in what time, Utkramati, Utkramati means he relinquishes this body, he leaves this body behind. You see, there is a big difference. in the Oriental thinking and the Western thinking in this area. That is what Mahatmas say. You know better. So, this is like this. It is the spirit which relinquishes the body. That is how the Gita looks at it. Whereas in the Western societies or Abrahamic faiths, I am not sure, that is what they say. It is the body which gives up the ghost. That's why this, so what is giving up what? There is a difference in thinking. So it is the body which is giving up ghost or spirit, whatever you call it. Whereas there it is the spirit which gives up the body. And that's why this understanding is reflected in Vyavahara also, in conducting the affairs with regard to this physical body. How? Once a person dies, giving up is what? Whether body gives up spirit or spirit gives up body, the result is what is called death, what is taken as death anyway. So, once the person dies, then the body becomes very important. Because it is the body which gives up ghost. So, body is all important. And now that body has to be taken care of. Whereas in India, it is the opposite. Once this person dies, they are in such a big hurry to destroy this body. They don't want to keep it one more hour with them. They take it to a godforsaken place. It is not kept any clean or any such thing. No need to keep it clean because it is not any sacred place or any such thing. You just take the body there. There is one small 6 feet by 4 feet area. In that area, by now, thousands of bodies are cremated. So, this body is kept, you can see the marks there. So, it is all black in color, soot and all that will be there. So, just dump this body there and put some wood and get over with it, over. And take that ashes and put in a river. River or a canal, whatever. So that they are dispersed. Prithivi goes into Prithivi. When you put fire to the body, apaha goes into apaha. They merge all over the place. They get united with the humidity of the atmosphere. Air mixes with the air. Tejas goes into tejas. And akasha is always there. Prithivi, they take the ashes and mix it with water. They are dispersed all over. Khatam, over. The body is no more there. And they go to that place just one more time on the third day to collect ashes. And afterwards, they don't even look at that site. It is nobody's site, it is. Whereas in the Western societies, my God, it is such a big effort to keep this body. And a particular place is allotted for the body. And that continues to be occupied by the body for hundreds of years. God knows how long. Anyway, they have a lot of land, doesn't matter. So, the entire thinking is different. It is Yachar Yukramati Ishvaraha. It is Ishvaraha, the Jivaha, who relinquishes the body. So when he does that, yet Yada, when? In which period? So when this Ishvara, namely the Jiva, relinquishes the body, so what he does? So Prakrutisthani, Manashrashthani Indriyani, Prakrutisthani Karshati. The jiva, the aham, it leaves this body together with the astral components. So, shodashakal of purushaha. We have seen that in Chandogya. So, this shodashakal of purushaha travels. He is the transmigratory soul. So, the pancha pranas, pranapana vyanodana samana, which I described earlier, and the pancha karmendriyas, their potentials. Karmendriyas means not hands and like indriya is not the physical anatomy. That is not indriya. Physical anatomy is the so is the prakruti, is the sthanam, is the physical apparatus in which the indriyam expresses itself. Like this is the physical this is the hand. Hand means just not a set of bones with a lot of flesh thrown around it. That is not hand. That is the anatomy of the hand. The real hand is the strength to lift weights. That is hand. So all these karmendriyas, the organs of action, they are in the potential form. In sleep, they are there in the potential form. Similarly, the sense organs, eyesight, hearing, etc., they are there in the potential form. They resolve in the mind in sleep. They come out, they blossom out of the mind when the person wakes up. So all these pancha jnanendriyas, pancha karmendriyas, pancha pranas, 15, plus mind, which holds them together, 16. All these 16 together with ahankara. When they combine ahankara, they call saptadashaha. When they keep the ahankara aside, they call shodashakalaha purushaha. So this shodashakala purusha, the astral body, with a sense of I associated with it, utkramati. It finds that this body cannot hold itself anymore, so it rises up. Means it just relinquishes this body. While doing so, it carries with itself, karshati. It pulls along with itself. So what? Manasrashthani indriyani. The 5 sense organs. Here sense organs are mentioned. And the mind also. Manasrashthani. Shastha means the 6th. So together with the 6th entity, which is the mind. Manasrashthani. So 5 sense organs and mind. Where are these sense organs and mind? They are collected, you know. While the person is going for a journey, he collects all the items from all the places. He collects sat from here, some other razor from here, mirror from here, something else from here. From all sides he collects and puts in a bag. Similarly, that is what is called karshati. So this jiva, he collects these indriyas from their respective anatomical locations. Prakrutisthani. Prakruti is deham, body. In this context, prakruti is the body, the physical body. So, they are in the physical body. In fact, you can also say, they are prakrutani. They are constituted by the satvarajastamo gunatmaka prakruti, the maya shakti, which is made up of sattva, rajas and tamas gunas. So, each one of these indriyas, they have arisen out of the same maya shakti. Therefore, they are essentially the products of prakruti. That is there. But here, prakruti sthani. So, which abide in the prakruti, which is the deham. So, that meaning also can be said. But more appropriately, prakruti sthani means prakrutau dehe sthitani. Shankara karna shishkulyadau sthitani. Suppose the faculty of hearing, where do you find it? You find it in this karna. It is there in this karna. Not in this lobe, with the akasha within that, and the drum, the ear drum, which has got that capacity to vibrate, and also a fluid which is there associated with the ear drum. So that fluid absorbs all these vibrations of the ear drum. And then the fluid has got nerve endings dipping into it. So these nerve endings, they detect. So these vibrations in that fluid. And they detect in terms of electrical currents. And they are carried to the brain. And in the brain, there is a center, a physical center, an anatomical center once again, which integrates all these nerve sensations. And it is the mind which recognizes them as an idea and throws up the idea. So this is the so-and-so sound. That kind of an idea is finally the mind which generates that idea. But then all this is illuminated by Atma Chaitanyam. Because all the way it is knowledge. It is knowledge of sound. Knowledge means Chaitanyam. So that is the sequence. So this faculty which resides in this Karna Shashkuli, this lobe, ear lobe, both ear lobes, this faculty is taken up. Then similarly the faculty of hearing, of seeing, it is picked up. Like this, all these faculties are there in the potential form, they are withdrawn. In sleep it happens every day. That's why death is called dirghanidra, a prolonged sleep, nothing more than that. Anyway, so this jiva, he collects all this, his paraphernalia. And so he travels. Where he travels? Shariram yadavapnoti. He gains another body elsewhere. In fact, it is presented in Brihadaranyaka that the other body is already fixed. In fact, unless the other body is fixed, this body is not relinquished. This is how the Shruti presents. We don't have any way of verifying, except we can always provide some logic for all this. So, they say, the Brihadaranyaka Shruti says, it uses an illustration of a caterpillar, Trunajalukavat. So the caterpillar, it will be crawling along the blades of grass. It is crawling on the grass, you know. So what it does, it is now sitting on a particular blade of grass. It prolongs, it protrudes its mouth and picks up the next blade of grass and tests its strength, whether it can hold itself or not. And when it is satisfied that the next blade of grass can really hold itself, then slowly it crawls and sits halfway on the next to that blade of grass. And now it is further satisfied that this blade of grass can hold it. Then it leaves the earlier blade of grass and now it is sitting on the next blade of grass. Like that it progresses. Similarly, this jiva also, even while residing in this physical body, he tests the next body which is already made, which is already there in the potential form. Bhava deha it is called. So, that's why bhava should be clean. Bhava means thinking. If the bhava is unclean, then the next body will be affected that way. You see, here the philosophy and science, they differ in a way. How? In science, they try to understand that the mind, consciousness, or the person, the personality traits, all as the epiphenomena of the gray matter of the brain matter. There is some matter here, gray matter, neurons and all that. They are physical in nature. They are molecules. So they have property. What is their property? Thinking, personality, all these are their property. So the mind, intellect and consciousness, they are epiphenomena of the physical matter. Matter first, spirit later. That is how the science looks at it. But in Vedanta, we say it is wrong. You have misunderstood the whole thing. For your laboratory experiments, elder, you go ahead. It may work all right. We don't come in the way. But you have put the cart before the horse. It is the spirit that precedes the matter, which is grass and which is subtle. It is the grass which comes after the subtle, not the other way. Therefore, it is the spirit first, intelligence or consciousness, whatever name you give to it, that comes first, and then a body grows around it. In fact, this growth of the body is a function of the mind only. How they say, this jiva is now impregnated in the mother's womb, and now the jiva is occupying or abiding in a cell. And that jiva, he has that bhavana. So, that intelligence, that potential, and that jiva expresses that potential. So, the jiva is provided food and nutrients. They are coming all the time. They are supplied to the jiva. And this food and nutrients, they take the shape of a particular physical body as desired by that jiva sitting there. Now the jiva desires that he wants hands, so hands are now coming. It wants legs, legs are coming. It wants eyes, eyes are coming. It wants a human body, human body is forthcoming. Why the jiva should desire for human body only? Because his karma is like that. His karma phalam, so it became fructified in that way. That's why he has entered into a human mother's womb. Otherwise, if his karma phalam drives him into an animal life, he will be in the animal mother's womb. Therefore, having entered into a particular mother's womb, his bhava deha means the intelligence body or the spiritual body, it directs the growth of the physical body. It is not the opposite. The first physical body grows and then jiva comes into it. No. It is the entirely opposite it is. So that physical body, which is going to be manifested or which is going to grow in the next mother's womb, that physical body is determined in a way while this guy is still sitting in this physical body. This is the Trunajaluka Nyayam. So caterpillar illustration. So like that they say. So while shariram yada vapnoti, he is about to gain another body, and that is being talked about while this jiva is still lingering in this body. Ichchap chutkramati, even while getting out of this body, he is still collecting his items. Manasvasthani indriyani prakriti sthani karshati. While collecting, he is collecting while getting up, and so while collecting and getting up, he is going to a next body which is already predetermined by Ishvara by virtue of his karma phalas, and that body is already known in a way to this fellow. So this is how we look at it. In fact, there is a journey. Journey requires two things. One is the ability, the shakti, prana shakti to conduct the journey. Second, a direction. You need gas in the car and also you need a map to go. So this direction into which body he has to go, that is the direction, marga darshanam. That is determined by the vasanas, and the journey itself requires the prana shakti that is there in the jiva, because he holds the pancha pranas also around him. Therefore, the astral body's prana component provides the energy required for the journey, and the astral body's vasana components, they provide the marga, they provide the route map of the journey. So, like this jiva's journey continues. So, you see, jiva is Brahman only, but what happens, he has to know that truth. You see, what is a jiva? The sat, sadekameva advatiyam, that sat expressing as consciousness in a physical body and mind. So, you have the sat, jivanatmana anupravishtaha, chandogya. So, sat plus physical body and mind. So, I always use the word this apparatus, psychosomatic apparatus, plus ignorance is equal to jiva. That ignorance you have to put. Otherwise, there is no jiva. A wave is there out of ignorance only. So, that ignorance component is there. And that ignorance is the bondage. It is like you have a pot, and there is water in that pot. Now a rope is tied to that pot. This pot is dipped into a well. You see, now the water inside the pot has found its source. It has originally come from that well, and now again it has merged into that well. Sata somya sada sampanno bhavati. That is what I am trying to give as an example. So, this water of the pot has merged into the whole, that is Brahman. But still, this string around the neck is there. Suppose that string around the neck is gone, then what happens to that water? It remains in the whole. It won't come up again. But because that pot is there, and around its neck there is the string, and so once again this water comes. And now it comes and goes elsewhere. Do you know what they do in villages? They take this water in the pot, put it into the well, and then again take it out. So, put it into the well, so it goes into the hole, and pick up again. So, this binding rope is there. That's why this water has to come up again. Suppose that binding rope is not there, then it need not come up again. So, we are talking of a jiva who is going to take rebirth, because the ajnana bandha is there. That's why shariram yadavapnoti, he has not yet understood his swarupa. Therefore, this individual thing, it continues, and so he will take another body. This is how it is understood. Then, generally a question, you see, this is an occasion for answering a few questions even before they are asked. Anyway, these questions will come in satsanga. They generally ask me, how do you know there is purva janma? I can straight away say, Lord Krishna talks about it. Over. Shariram yadavapnoti, yachap yutkramati ishvaraha. Ishvaraha jivaha, yada utkramati, from this body he rises up. Shariram yadavapnoti, he gains another body. Over. Statement from Gita is the pramanam. It is an authentic statement. It helps us to know a truth which we otherwise cannot know. And so, that I quote, and there it ends. In India, if a quotation is given like this, that is taken final. They will not ask any more questions. In the first place, they will ask, sir, how do you know that there is a Purva Janma? Bhagavan said, when you quote and say, it is Shrute, or it is Smrute, over. That answer we can give. But then, Shankara goes once more step forward, and tries to explain it by Nyaya. Shruti Smruti Nyaya. Shruti is Veda, the main source of knowledge. So Shruti talks about this Jivagati. So in Chandogya Upanishad, the Panchamadhyaya, we are now studying 6th chapter. The 5th chapter elaborately discusses this Jivagati. That is the Shruti. Of course, Brihadaranyaka talks, various other Shrutis talk about it. But Chandogya is taken to be the main Shruti in this area. One entire Adhyaya is devoted for it. Then Smruti, Bhagavan talks about it here, that is Smruti. Then comes Nyaya. And here Bhagavan gave a very interesting example, Gruhitvaitani Sanyati. So this Jivaha, Ishvaraha, Etani Gruhitva. So Etani means Manashrashthani Indriyani. So the 5 sense organs and Manas, Prana and the other 5 Karmendriyas are also included. They are not explicitly mentioned in this particular part of the verse, but they are included. So, Shodashakal of Purushaha. So, the Jiva goes, Gruhitva Etani Sanyati. He carries all this baggage with him. So, and the Karmaphala Samskaras or Vasanas are held in the mind. Don't think that Ishvara will be keeping in a file with him. No. The file is with you. Ishvara is with you only. The file is with you. It is like this. In certain factories, they give an electronic identity card. So what you have to do is, while entering into the factory, you punch it. Punch it, or it's a magnetic strip type of card. You just push it through and take and put it in your pocket. And while coming out, you do that. So there a person will be standing, and he will be watching whether you do it properly or not. He will help you also. Like that you do for 30 days. After 30 days, this punch card, electronic card, is submitted to the finance department. They will take out the number of hours worked by you, and where you have worked, how much salary you get, all that, that data they take from this only. And they make payment. That is how they do. You assume they do like that. For the sake of example, you take it like that. So, similarly, the next body is to be determined by the karmaphala. And the karmaphalas are here only. It is not that karmaphalas are, when Chitragupta ji, he is keeping account, and every time Bhagavan has to telephone to Chitragupta and ask where I should send this fellow. It is not like that. It is said like that in a story. But the karmaphala, the vasanas, they abide in the manas, manashrashthani indriyani. Therefore that manas holds the entire code for the next birth. Shariram yadavapnoti. Grihit vaitani sanyati. So then what is the role of Ishvara? The role of Ishvara is the karma phala, the karma, the law of karma is Ishvara. And so that law of karma, Ishvara is present in the form of that law of karma. That is the role of Ishvara. Anyway, so the example given is Vayur Gandha Nivashayat. Very interesting example. You see, there is a bed of flowers in the garden. Now a small breeze is coming. From the garden, it is entering through the window into the drawing room. And the person sitting in the drawing room can recognize the fragrance of the flowers. So this vayu, it picks up the fragrance from the flowers. It doesn't disturb the flower. The weight of the flower is not altered. Its weight is same. The number of the leaves like thing, other things, the structure of the flower, it is not disturbed. So every aspect of the pollen, everything remains there only. Everything sits there. Vayu does not disturb the flower physically. Just he picks up the fragrance, and you cannot see it. It is not possible to see. Similarly, this jiva, he is leaving this body, you cannot see it with your eyes. That's why that example is given. Vayur gandha nivashaya. Nobody can come and say, oh, we were looking at him all the time. We have not seen any jyoti or any light or any power raising up from the body. We have not seen. Therefore, you are talking something not acceptable. You cannot say like that. When vayu picks up fragrance, you cannot see that. Still, it is there. Similarly, here also, though you cannot see with your eyes, it is not available for eyesight, but still it happens. Vayur gandhaniva ashayat, this jiva, he picks up the entire structure of the astral body and goes away. Like that it happens. So, I was talking about the nyaya. So, the rationale of punarjanma. Because shariram yadava apnoti, the jiva survives the death of the body. So, Shankara gave a certain kind of rationale. In Chandogya Upanishad Bhashyam, he has described this. Generally, suppose you ask me, how do you say that there is rebirth? I say, you want a proof, right? That is why you are asking the question. What kind of proof you are expecting? You tell me that. If you may say, a person must be available with us now, and this person knows his earlier birth, and he gives an account of his earlier birth, and we independently verify that account. And if that proves to be correct, then we can say, here is an example of rebirth. So, if we show one example like that, we can extrapolate it to every other individual. In the case of other individuals, for some reason, they don't remember their earlier birth, whereas this gentleman, for some unusual reason, he is able to remember it, and we are able to verify it independently. If this kind of a proof is satisfactory for you, then I tell you, you have not dozens or hundreds, you have thousands of such examples. Thousands and thousands. Even just before coming here in India, I have seen an Indian Express report. In Maharashtra, in a remote village, in a poor family, a small boy was born, and his age is 3. And he was born in some working class family. They are daily wage earners, they are not highly educated or any such thing, they are illiterate really. So this boy, he starts reciting at the age of 3 Vedas, Vedic mantras. And in fact, this boy's father, his grandfather, nobody in that family, as far as they could know, never recited one Veda mantra, either from the mother's side or from the father's side. And this boy's age is 3, and he was born in that hut, and he was still crawling in that hut only. There was no occasion for him to learn these mantras, and nobody in that village also knows. Now, they examined this boy, and they asked a few questions. He is a child prodigy in any case. So he told, in my earlier birth, I was in Himachal Pradesh and I studied Vedas there. That is what he told. And so these people made a trip to Himachal Pradesh and verified his account. It proved to be correct. And this is an investigative journalist. He publishes it. Like this, any number of examples are there. Therefore, if that kind of a proof is what you are looking for, then it is. It is there. If you want not that kind of proof, just you want a rationale, then it is there. How? Shankara describes it like this. You think about it, whether you like it. You see, a child is born, and now the child is crying. The child has not yet tasted food. It doesn't know what is food. Just now it is born. Then the child is crying, and then the mother gives him milk. Some milk, breast milk or whatever milk. That moment the child stops crying. So, the child gives an indication in its own way. He cannot say, give me milk. So, in its own way, the child is giving an indication that it wants nutrition. It wants food. Now, the question is, If the child has known food once, then the samskara will be there, and so it will ask for food a second time. It is like you go to a movie one time and so next time you will go. But first one time you have to go and see it, or somebody else has to say to you, it will be wonderful, come on, I will take you. Like that, for the first time you need somebody to introduce that thing to you, into your mind. Then it stays as a vasana and that carries along. But very first time you have to explain. That's why they ask, did you see, what is the very first picture you have seen? Like that they ask, because that means a lot. That from then onwards the entire vasana cycle has started. So similarly, this child, what is the very first vasana of desiring food in this life? It was not there. Yet this child is seeking food, desiring food. So Shankara says, this vasana of hunger, recognition of hunger and seeking food to appease hunger, it is there for the child from the earlier birth. That is one example. Then he gives a second example. The child has just now opened the eyes. Probably the child does not open the eyes for a few days, I suppose. But the first time the child has opened the eyes, then you go and move an object, say hand, before the eyes like that. Something, some quick movement before the eyes. Then immediately the child closes the eyes. And you can recognize fear in the child. And that is the first expression of fear in the child. But then you see, suppose somebody hits me and that a slap, and the slap is painful, and therefore I suffer because of that. And next time, when a hand is coming near me, I recognize all that, and so I move away, like an animal. You ask it to come near and you give a beating to it, then it won't come near the person a second time, because that samskara will be there. But very first samskara of fear, where from it has come for this child? It is not picked up in this life. The second samskara of fear is always from the first. But very first one? So this bhayam, sense of insecurity, the child indicates that it is insecure. For the first time that indication is there. And that must have come from the earlier birth. So these two examples are given by Shankara in a given context to indicate, to prove that there is rebirth. And then Shankara makes a little more effort to establish rebirth. He uses a very interesting language. He says, akuruta bhyagamaha kruta pranashashya. These two compound words he used at least in a dozen places to establish rebirth. You see, a child is born in a Texas millionaire's family. So the moment the child is born, he has inherited $1 million and a big ranch and house and all that. Whereas another child is born in a poor man's hut in some remote place, say in India or some other third world country. Now, the two children are born at the same time. And if there is a God who has given, who is finally responsible for their birth, and they don't have any history to determine the quality of their birth, just they happened to exist from this moment only. This child did not exist before this moment, and now it starts existing. Same is the case of that child. Why so much disparity? What for? Why God should be so cruel about it? Why he should be having this kind of a nepotism, whatever they call it? He should not do that. When two children were given, were sent into this world by the same God, then why they, and both are existing, this is how they say, jiva is born at the time of birth. Before that there was no jiva, and there is no history. Then why there should be any disparity whatsoever? Therefore, it is not acceptable. So, you should say that each child has a history in terms of its previous birth. And that, so this child's punya karma is good. Therefore, it is born with a lot of wealth and all that. Whereas that child is unfortunate in that area. And therefore, it is born in a poor man's family. You have to accept it. If you do not accept rebirth, then akuruta abhyagama. a person is gaining some sukha or dukkha which is not due to him. This akruta, which is not due, abhyagama, it is coming to the fellow. This is not acceptable. This is a, this logic, this way you cannot say that. And still say the God is impartial. Then kruta pranashaha, a person has lived a very virtuous life. And another person has lived, he is given to many wrong actions and very irresponsible life. He did not bother to gather virtue in his life. Now both have died, and if that puts an end to the both jivas, then what should be, what you are saying is, all the virtue of this person's life is, it comes to a knot. Similarly, all the vice of this person's life also comes to a knot. Krita pranashaha. Therefore, you have to say, krita has nothing to give as a result later. This is also not acceptable. In fact, I would like you to look at it from this life's point of view alone. In this life, a young man works hard during the student days. Another young man is given to all wastage of time, and so he goes to movies, this and that, doesn't read properly, and both come out of the university. One of them, the person who did not study well, who did not work hard in the university, will be washing windows in some building. Whereas the other person who worked hard, he will be doing a good job. Here itself you have the disparity. Both of them are friends from the same university. So they meet on the road. Then one is an executive in a company, the other is he washes windows. Nothing wrong, any job is good. But he will be feeling bad about it. Both are in the same class, one's lot is like this, the other person's fortunes are like that. But I tell you, is it that somebody, government has favored one over the other? Or God has favored one over the other? No, nobody has favored anybody. There is no free lunch in this world. So, they made what they got. They get what they deserve. This is the law of this life, of this world. And so this continues. And just the fall of the physical body will not nullify this law. It continues. Krita pranashaha is not acceptable. So, we say, rebirth is very essential to explain this world. If you say, jagat is mithya, then you don't bother about rebirth and all that. But if you say, there is an empirical reality for this world, you have to explain it, then you have to rely upon rebirth. In fact, once I was following a trial of a case in Oklahoma, and in New York Times I was regularly following, not this time, in last season. One person was, he was a killer, and so he was given capital punishment. And so he killed a young boy, and the mother of that boy, she is allowed to give a speech. This is a very interesting legal system here. It is followed very systematically. The courts, etc., they function very well, like everything else. Whereas in some of the third world countries, just there is nothing like a court system. A person commits murder. If his relatives take revenge, it's all right. Otherwise, he goes unpunished. Bhagavan has to punish him later. And of course, that way we take it also. Here, they don't care for Bhagavan's punishment and all that. They want him to be punished now and here. They are very particular about it. Probably that may not be correct, in my opinion. And they attend this session also. When the person is put to death, they attend that session. Because they want to see him dying. Because he has caused the death of their own near and dear. So that kind of feelings are there in the society, which are not very good in my opinion. It should not be there like that. Anyway, that apart, so that lady in her speech, after the punishment is awarded, in her speech she says, the karma theory is proved to be correct. That is what she said. I was surprised to read that. Where from she got this karma theory? In Oklahoma, and she is a Catholic, and all that information is available there. And she talks of a karma theory. Very interesting. Therefore, so this idea of a karma theory is there in the minds of the people. Somehow they sense it. That itself is the best proof for it. It doesn't require any more proof. In spite of A teaching to the opposite, people somehow take it to their hearts. So the karma theory, it works. And of course, in Shastras it is there. In the world's religions, Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, they all accept rebirth. Jainism and Buddhism, they accept rebirth. So all the oriental faiths, they accept rebirth. Even in the Abrahamic faiths, they accept rebirth halfway. So the person dies here and takes rebirth in heaven. They have that journey, etc. is there, heaven or hell. But they don't accept it just before birth here. So that is a bit problem. So they have to work out that a little. We say reincarnation is a reality, is a truth of this empirical world. In an empirical world, in the Paramartha Satyam, everything is mithya. So rebirth is mithya, this birth is mithya, this death is mithya, rebirth is also mithya. So we, like this, we try to understand it. We'll continue tomorrow in the next class. ॐ पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः हरिः ॐ श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ॐ तत्सत् श्रीकृष्णार्पणमस्तु